Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Joseph Weiler, and I'd like to welcome all of you to the highlight of our inauguration of the Straus Institute. It's our great pleasure and honor to have with us Professor Amartya Sen.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for asking me.
We also have with us here on the stage my colleague, Professor Moshe Halbertal from NYU and the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, and three of our Straus Fellows this year, Professor Andrew Harrell from Oxford, Professor Gronja de Burke from Fordham, but really being wooed assiduously by Harvard, and my colleague Dick Stewart, who this year is also a Straus Fellow. And what we will do, we will carry a conversation with Professor Sen. And you see that I'm not doing the usual introductions, not only because Professor Sen does not need an introduction, but because we're going to spend the first part of the evening asking him some questions about his life. And with your permission, sir, I'd like to go to your early life, because you were born and grew up in India under the Raj. And we know it from the Raj Quartet, we know it from Kipling, we know it from the literature, but it would be nice to hear from somebody who actually lived through it, both in your early childhood and as you grew up. Just give us a flavor of what it was like to grow up in that period in that country.
That is a complex question, I have to say. You know, I think in some ways the influence of the Raj in where you're living was so extensive in every way, affecting law and order, affecting freedom of speech, affecting exposure to literature and access to English poetry, for example. But you know, there's a kind of inescapably a complexity there, and I don't know that one can give one a flavor of what's going on without referring to the tensions in it. You know, I think there's no question, I think very few people would be, who are fortunate enough to go to school or college, would not have been happy to the fact that you had exposure to Shakespeare and a whole lot of writing, Marvel and Dryden and Byron and Tennyson and so on. And at the same time, there was also the rough end of the Raj. When my consciousness began, I think most of my uncles, I think in India you tend to call them uncles, though they're basically cousins of fathers or mothers, I think most of them were in prison. Not because they had done anything, but they were under what is called Preventive Detention Act. And so that was, so quite a lot of the Sundays were spent in visiting various prisons, like Presidency Jail, Alipur Jail, and so on. So it's a mixture of that. So I don't quite know what aspect one, I mean, it affected us, our lives, in so many different ways.
A lot of Indian friends and colleagues describe a certain ambivalence, a lifelong ambivalence towards the British. Does that resonate with you?
No.
A kind of...
No, because I think ambivalence comes when there is a, you know, unclear understanding about what the relationship is. But if you say that the relationship has many different aspects, that's not an ambivalence.
What would you say from that period, the formative period as a boy and a youth, would have been the most formative experiences that remained with you. If you can look at your life later as an adult, and all of us can look back to our childhood and remember certain things that we think imprinted themselves on us. Do you have any such thoughts, any such impressions from that period?
Well, difficulty is identifying one of them. In some ways, some of the strongest impressions were not directly connected with the empire, but they are. I mean, certainly one of my earliest memories is that of the Bengal famine of 1943, in which 3 million people died. Now, is it an imperial phenomenon? Well, the British Empire began with a big famine. It ended with a big famine. There hasn't been a famine since then. So in some ways, it's not unrelated to the imperial presence.
Was your family directly affected?
No. There are very few families that are affected. That's the issue of class that I think is... First of all, just generally, people may not quite know it, because people don't have to spend as much time happily as I had to studying famine, not because I suffered from it, but because I was studying it as an economist. I mean, very few famine in the world affects more than 10% of the population. The highest proportion of famine population, proportion of population affected by a famine is not a European famine, it's an Irish, it's the Irish famine of the 1840s. And that, of course, is also an imperial phenomenon, very much so. So actually, empire is certainly mixed up with that, there's no question. Certainly, the movement for independence was a very big part of our lives, and just preceding 43, 42, when I was 8 to 9 years old, depending on which part of the year, this would be, we had this August Rebellion and so on. And again, a lot of my relations get arrested. One of them dies in jail. And that's a part of the phenomenon too. And yet throughout the period, one is having visits from, in my school in Shantiniketan, exciting people there. I was very young, but there was Charlie Andrews and Pearson and a lot of other really interesting guys to chat with. The exposure to a kind of global appreciation of knowledge, which is really, in some ways, one of the gifts of the European Enlightenment. I have tried to argue in my recent book, Idea of Justice, that Enlightenment is not especially a European phenomenon. And that's true. But you don't have such a cluster, such a outburst of that thing as you do in 18th century France and Scotland. But of course, Britain is affected by it, and so is the British India in a big way.
Are there any people in particular, your parents, teachers, political leaders, that stick in your mind from that period, whom you admired or whom you hated?
That's very difficult. There are so many people to admire. Well, I was in a school that was started by Rabindranath Tagore, so he was there. I was less receptive to him then than I was now, because he seemed to me like a cult figure, and which he was. But of course, he also said very interesting things, so I think in some ways you need a little bit of distance to be able to, you're too contaminated within it to be able to get that distant view. But you know, there are huge memories of people visiting my school. We had a visit from the Roosevelts, and I already knew something about Eleanor Roosevelt, which was before, well before, 48 was where she played a major part in the Human Rights, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. But she spoke to us on that subject. That was what she was addressing the school on. We had a visit from Mr. and Mrs. Chiang Kai-shek. And given the nature of the Shantiniketan's preparation for the visit, they spoke in Chinese for 20 minutes each without translation. And I have to say that the civility of the students have not been tested more strongly ever before and after. And I felt very sad about them because Madame Chiang Kai-shek actually did speak English, but for some reason she didn't. I think often there's the dignitary issue, you have to speak in your language. And when later I was privileged to ask to talk with her and tea, she said that she found it difficult to think that why there was no translation. So I said, yes, I find it difficult to think as well. So they were visiting dignitaries, their local resident. Gandhiji came a number of times. That was a huge influence. I think the literature had a big thing in Shantiniketan at that time. Rabindranath Tagore was the natural name, but there were great guys. I think the person who I still think wrote probably the finest Bengali ever is a man called Syed Mustafa Ali, who was a resident in Shantiniketan at that time. I think for a while he had moved to the east, to what was East Pakistan, for a very brief while. Then there was, of course, I never saw him. There was a Qazi Nazrul Islam, who was a great poet. Not often recognized, wrote more poems than Rabindranath had written. And many of them are absolute part of growing up in Bengal. So I think there was all these things. You know, they're the great moments, they're the...
When did it become clear in your mind that there would be independence?
It was entirely clear in my mind there would be, but the question was why it's taking so long was the main issue, I think.
So can you tell us a little bit about the period that immediately before independence?
And then you see, what happened then, that the life got very badly disrupted by, a tussle between independence on one side and partition on the other. And underlying the partition, the riots. Bengal had not traditionally had many riots. But that was when Bengal went to partition. That was, it had erupted in a big way, in a huge way, on both on what would later be East Pakistan and now Bangladesh, and what is now West Bengal. Big killings in Calcutta, big killings in Dhaka, and so on, and elsewhere, Noakhali, and so forth. And those were, in a sense, that was much more in many people's mind, and even those who were ardent supporters of the partition, there were quite a lot, certainly in my family, who took the view that there was being an undue rush for independence, because at the time the independence was going to be definitely with partition. That was the view of that Gandhi. Gandhi thought that you should try to prevent the partition if you could, and worked in that direction. And there's some reason to take. I mean, there's a very interesting history by a Pakistani historian called Aisha Jalal, called The Sole Spokesman. It's about Jinnah, who was actually a five-band Congress leader at one stage, and certainly had a very secular lifestyle, you know, drinking whiskey and so on. But on the other hand, he wanted a different status of Muslims in India. And I think Aisha Jalal's story is accepted. Basically took the view of partition as a possible threat, as a tactical argument. And in a sense, by that time, if that story goes, that Congress, including Nehru and Mountbatten, Mountbatten was so anxious to leave and Nehru was so anxious to become prime minister. That's the story that, you know, you'd hear that disputation on that too.
How old were you then?
Well, I was 13 when India became independent.
And do you remember your feelings of excitement, fear, maybe both? Excitement.
I think the riots were so dominant in my mind that something of the quality of independence was undoubtedly lost in that. And since I come from an academic family, my father was a professor at Dhaka University, now in Bangladesh, and my grandfather was in Shantiniketan, and so on. So there was a lot of, possibly not unknown in the law school in NYU, that there are different points of view. So within the family, there were some who thought it was a very good idea to get independence no matter what. And the other point of view that this is a great mistake, there's too much is being made in us. I remember spending a lot of time thinking about that issue. I did stay up and hear Nehru giving his speech, which I thought was a good speech.
And then in the years immediately after independence, what did that do to your lives?
Well, there were different things happening. There was, first of all, the riots did flare up. And I think the defining moment when Gandhiji played again a role was to quell that. And he played a very big part in that. I mean, in some ways, it's an easy. I mean, it's sometimes people don't write of, there is the history to be written. I've got two great Bangladeshi, one historian, one economist sitting there. The economist, Lamont, so one was a classmate of mine in Cambridge. And Raunak has also written about the history of Bangladesh and so on, among others. But you see, I think there are a lot of special things about Bangladesh. It's a only firmly Muslim-majority country which seemed to be gone against the trend, having a more secular move towards more secularism rather than away from it. But you see, also, the riots came late. Bengal was decisive for the partition, and until the Bengali Muslim leadership went in that direction, it wasn't clear that Muslim League was going to get there. So I think it's a hugely important one. On the other hand, it is a base where there's a very strong Bengali nationalism, on which, of course, the Bangladeshi independent movement started. Bear in mind that what was the dominant theme, namely Hindu-Muslim animosity in 47, within about 4 years, the main dominant theme is Bengali language movement, no imposition of Urdu. Same religion, but a different language. So I think in some ways there's things to be written to what extent Gandhiji's success in Bengal was possible. And it was a success, people often deny that, but there was a role in that. Was possible precisely because it was Bengal. Would he have been equally successful in Punjab, where the history was very different? I just don't know.
Let's return to you. So now you reach 17, 18, and we want to know a little bit about your intellectual formation. At what point did you begin to articulate or to charter your subsequent trajectory?
Can you improve the miking? It's very hard to hear.
We will try to speak a little. Is this
speak
better?
Getting it closer? Is it getting better?
That's much better.
It's getting better.
So I asked him.
I was once told by a singer in a nightclub, in fact, that the right thing to do is to try to kiss it without actually kissing it. But I'm not sure I can do quite such a degree of brinkmanship, but I'll try. Am I better now?
Yes.
I don't mean character-wise, but yeah.
So we are interested in your formation when you began to chart what became your subsequent interest and career, etc.
Well, it was, I mean, the period that you're dealing with is a very formative period. And 2 years after that, I will go to, or 3 years after that, I'll go to Calcutta Presidency College, which was an elite college with an established early 19th century called the Hindu College. It was actually not often recognized. It was not just a government initiative. It's not a British Empire thing. There were a lot of strong civilian movements, including local British, often Christian, as well as local Bengali gentry who were involved in that. And then it was changed, the name was changed from Hindu College to Presidency College by, I think, 1850s or something like that. So by the time I went there, it was been that like that for 100 years. It was a frankly elite college. It was a very good college. My main interest in those days used to be maths, and it was physics until I came there, but I met some people who were in economics whom I found more interesting than my maths colleagues. And people like Sukumar Chakravarti and others played a big part. They were, the names won't mean anything much to you because they did publish a lot, but they're not so remembered now. But they were captivating figures, so I wanted to chat with them, and we have something similar. We were interested in India, we were interested in objectivity. None of us were religious. None of us had very strong antecedent belief. We didn't have a very strong community identity. Incidentally, I should have mentioned that one of the questions I'm often asked, why do I sound so hostile to communitarian philosophy generally? If you grew up among Hindu-Muslim riots, it's very difficult for you to live in a state where you think that communitarianism is the solution rather than the problem in the world. So they had huge impact on me. But at that time, the tensions were not of that kind. I think the tensions were much more connected with politics. I was certainly on the left of politics. And the dominant left was, of course, Marxist and communist. And in Presidency College, they were very strong. I was part of the student movement, which was there, but not in the Communist Party. But I was part of the movement, which was involved in that. And yet the tensions were very strong, because one would have to be pretty ignorant by the early 50s not to have taken a view about what happened in the purges, and reading John Gunter saying that on the day of the trial, the accused people who all confessed looked as if they had not been tortured, just made one think that how far can brainwashing go to do that. So I think these were the big tensions. And some indication of that would be also reflected in the way the left politics was run. There's a tendency towards a hegemonic politics, which many of us dislike, without disputing the fact that the left was trying to say something which nobody else in India was saying, namely that poverty does matter, and then the judging progress is to be done by that and not with where you have economic growth. The same issue that comes up again and again. That's the perennial issue. It came back again under Mahbubul Haq's leadership with the Human Development Movement. Came back again in the commission that Sarkozy arranged, which Joe Stiglitz was the chair, and I was called the chair advisor. And we were seemed to be revisiting the same territory, just GDP. Matter, how much does it matter, and what view do you take about distribution, about class? But very, very big issue that. And those tensions I lived through in Presidency College in Calcutta, where I got my first degree.
Then you moved to England.
Then I moved to England. But you see, that was a big thing, while shortly thereafter came very many things which confirmed some of the fears. Came the 20th Congress, came Khrushchev's denunciation of Joe Stalin. So the tension was very deep, because there was on one side the fact that there's no other political party, the Congress, which would be natural, and most of my family were Congress. One member was Communist Party, who stayed on in East Pakistan, and was quite a famous writer in Bangladesh, stayed on there. But basically, the family was a Congress family. But it was clear to me that the Congress's urgency about poverty removal and worrying about education, healthcare, etc., was minuscule in comparison with what it should be, notwithstanding what Nehru said on the 14th of December at 11:55 p.m. And so that was the tension, and the left were pushing something, not on education. I think they were totally deluded on the education. Communist Party were totally deluded on that. They have a kind of highly elitist view, not like what the communists, the only thing that the communists eventually, when you look back, did was education. That's what they did in Vietnam and Cuba, and a bit of healthcare, but nothing else. But there was not enough commitment there. But in other respects, poverty, healthcare more, there was concern about the left. But on the other hand, you got it at in a lump. You got it at a lump in the form of, you know, the radicalism has to go with the conservatism of the kind of which the established left has made a cult. And that's one of the reasons why many years later, and I know that you're proceeding so systematically, feel very unsystematic and busting the order. I had a kind of presence in America in years of special movement, so much so that I begin to question the statistical technique we use called factor analysis, in those days very common, seeing what are associated most, a kind of glorified regression, but not regression, I emphasize. But I was here in, I arrived in Berkeley in the fall of 64. So that was the year of the free speech movement. I was in Harvard in the spring of 68. I was visiting New York with a rented apartment in Columbia in the summer of 68. I visited Paris in the early summer of 68. And I told myself that any factor analysis would identify me as the root cause creating all these problems. But one reason why they were such here, when people ask me, why did I find them so elevating, so interesting? I did, actually. Partly, of course, it's happening in America is something, because it was, I think the view about how to view America is still a problem in India, and one of the respects recently, I've had a debate with the General Secretary of the Communist Party, because I made a criticism before their electoral fortune turned against him, saying that, well before the election, saying that their policies are totally disastrous, because they're the kind of gut anti-Americanism, which they don't seem to be able to overcome. But there was a basis for that kind of attitude. It was nice to see all these things. I found that year in Berkeley fantastic. But part of the thing is not just that it was happening in America, but it is also that you're getting radicalism without that conservative, cap on it, which you remember, if you remember the left-wing movement, there's a real tension in when people can't understand how could the communists have been so popular in places like Vietnam and Indonesia and China and even India, and because we know what the communists are like, because we know what happened in Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, but they're two completely different things. That's a rebellious movement protesting against an order. But the difficulty, of course, is the moment there is change, a new order comes smacking down on that. And so in that context, I found the fact that there could be a great deal of radicalism, not necessarily very left in the classic sense, but certainly radical, and not right radical either. I mean, insofar as anything is left radical. But without having the inheritance that Khrushchev was exposing in the 20th Congress, was a huge sense of liberation. I had a sense, am I still audible? Yeah? If somebody has to reply, because otherwise it could be that you can't hear me. Yeah, I am. Yeah, okay. Okay, good. Good, thank you. My friend, Tom Friedman, with whom I have some disagreement, he quoted, and also I like his writing very much, but he quoted me in his book about the world is flat, or the earth is flat, I forgot what it is called. But he quoted me saying that I thought the fall of the Berlin Wall was a huge event. And the question is why so? Because I think quite aside from the fact that he's liberated, of course, he's German, and you know, okay. All right. Okay. Thank you. Am I sounding much better? Okay. I think it's also liberated the left movement to some extent. You know, this whole image of a left movement that keeps people inside with a wall. I mean, if you think about the whole history of left-wing movement, beginning from the early radicalism in Europe, I mean, it just is unbelievable to think that that would be the form. And so the busting of the Berlin Wall was a huge contribution to the left, and not just to the freedom of the East Germans wanting to go to West Germany and people moving around from one place to other. So I think all these things, these tensions were very big in my life in Calcutta. I spent most of my time, it's amazing that I learned any economics because we seem to spend most of our time discussing it. We had the most active coffee house where we congregated, and it was a very nice place, I have to tell you. You had a lot of people visiting there, including people like film directors like Satyajit Ray and so on, who was also in Shantiniketan with me. I knew him as a student. There were a lot of really exciting people to argue with and discuss things. And so that's it. Then President, when I left and came to Cambridge, it was a different time. Then Raman Sovan and others erupt into my life there in Cambridge.
You've spent a big part of your life in Britain at Cambridge, Oxford. And you've spent a good chunk in the United States. How do you compare the experiences?
Well, I think it's easy to say they're different.
Yes.
I think there used to be some differences which are quite clearly identifiable. I think and it doesn't deal only with such issues as capital punishment, but that's certainly one of them. Nor with such issues to say that an immediate suspicion that if government does something, it must be wrong. Given the fact that very conservative writers like Hobbes and Locke spend their lifetime explaining why state is necessary for a good society, it's amazing that that should have become the right-wing position. But that's not the right-wing position of the... I mean, one big difference is that the Tories, the conservatives, will get utterly upset if you describe them as being opposed to, what is it called, socialized medicine. Whereas in America, actually, I believe that, at least initially when I came looking at the rhetoric, it looked to me that American mothers made their children drink milk by threatening them with socialized medicine if they didn't. And that was a completely different atmosphere from the European sense. But on the other hand, I think the idea that there is something like a right that a person has is something where I think Europe, I found, and Britain too, despite the fact that that's the place of that's where Tom Paine came from and Mary Wollstonecraft lived. But I think there is, now this is the time to use ambivalent on that subject. I think we were, Moshe and I were discussing the different attitude between Europe and America in the context of First Amendment and free speech. And that's a very basic difference. It comes in a very small way too. I think I'm immigrated into both the countries, and when I moved into England, I mean, I was there earlier, at the time when there were no visa restriction. India was part of the Commonwealth. I stood in the same queue as the British and got in, so that was the time in the 50s when I came in. It was easiest. Europeans and Americans stood in a queue. We did not. It seemed like a very far, far away time. But eventually, when in 73, when I moved to London School of Economics and later to Oxford, I came in, there were certain entitlements you have when you're settling in. The settlement was done by both places, by a similar process of claiming whatever it is that they claim, the institution claimed on your behalf. But the treatment was completely different. In the British case, it seemed to be very much trying to tell me that I have less entitlement to bring people in than like children or parents. My father was dead, then by my mother. Indeed, I had an entitlement to bring my widowed mother, but that wasn't revealed to me. Whereas when I came to America, I then have four children, two from a later marriage, one of whom is sitting here, but there were two earlier who were in India and who had no intention of moving. So when I was interviewed in Grosvenor House, and they told me that I do have right to bring them in, but to get the green card, that is, and then of course in the fullness of time you convert the green card into a citizenship. And he said that notice that there are two other children you have, but they do have the same entitlement. I hope somebody has told you. I was very impressed by that. There was the immigration officer telling me that. And I did say, my God, this is a difference from European culture. Now, I take a clear side that the European culture has some superiority when it comes to attitude to the state or attitude to... Actually, I shouldn't say the Americans are always against the state because they're not seem to be opposed, at least in some parts of the country, to state executing people. So there's some admiration for the state in some role. But if one finds that to be rather alien, I think the rights culture, since that was part of the political rhetoric, that was even a part of the rhetoric that had been absorbed in the Indian nationalist movement.
Maybe this is a good point to move a little bit to the world of ideas. And we've been reading at the Straus Institute your most recent book on the idea of justice.
I'm amazed, actually. Thank you.
We even had a little reading group. And I'd like to invite my colleague, Moshe Halbertal, perhaps to engage you a little bit with the ideas of that book.
So, Amartya, you have been so much part of your life was to think about what makes people better off in terms of your work on hunger, your concern with issues of literacy, gender. You have made a great contribution in this field. But you when you think about the issue of how do we measure whether people are better off or not? You come with a very interesting position that happiness is not the main thing. So I want to ask you, we have a lot of people here, what do you have against happiness?
I have not. I mean, to say that I have nothing against happiness would be an understatement. But I have nothing against a person's own... It's not a good criteria, but it's not a bad criteria either, to say if a person becomes happier, then something is happening to the person. Right. I can know many, many exceptions, but on the other hand... But they're sophisticated exceptions. In general rule, rough and ready, it's pretty good. But you know, in social judgments, you don't only have to judge whether how an individual's life is going, but you have to compare disadvantage of people. And if you were to take the view that the happy people are advantage and the unhappy people are disadvantage, then you get a scale which is extremely complicated. We didn't worry Jeremy Bentham 1 second, but did worry John Stuart Mill a great deal. I think people adapt to adversity, create a little happiness in an otherwise denuded life. When I was I spent more than a decade working on famines, And when sometimes I visited these places, I've never seen happier people than somebody having a meal after starving for 2 weeks. And it's a kind of indescribable happiness. But to say that that guy is better off than other people who are wondering whether he really likes Aristotle or Plato, I think would be to completely miss the signaling that happiness does. I don't want to be the crude biological thinker and sociologist to think that happiness had a selective purpose. A lot of people have selective purposes, a lot of things have, which are not pursued for the selective purpose. Having sexual relations is one of them, right, which is clearly has a selective purpose. It helps the survival of the population and its procreation. On the other hand, that's not the only reason why people pursue that.
So we have to grow.
But happiness has this role, which has this befuddling thing, because the signaling works reasonably well for an individual. But if you're really going to look at the disadvantaged people, it's terrible. And it particularly hit, you were very kind, while I'm referring to gender, I worked on gender, and it comes out most clearly there, because when you are established in a society where there people have come to accept an inferior position for women, they accept a lifestyle with happiness, quote-unquote, which is one of great restriction, and they've come to terms with it. And you know, sometimes it happens even by sublimating the question about your happiness into a family happiness. When I first started work on that, and this is autobiography, in the 1960s in Delhi, when I was professor at Delhi University, and said I was working on gender, there was a complete incomprehension, because the left was quite convinced that class was important, but gender is not. And the right was convinced that everything was fine, and there's not much to worry about anyway. So, and they thought that it was an eccentricity. My friends thought it was an amiable eccentricity that I was concerned. But my anthropological colleagues pointed out in a famous meeting where I was chastised that I don't seem to recognize that Indian women don't have a conception of their individual happiness. Now, I can't think of something which is a more ultimate denial of a person's basic freedom than to lose a sense of individuality.
Right.
And so I think that's what's wrong with the happiness.
Right. So the idea that the expansion of capacities and freedoms as a measure of being better off doesn't correlate into happiness as a category.
No.
Yeah. Now, you have, in the book itself, I think one of the main contributions is you have been resisting articulating a theory of justice, a grand theory of justice, right? There is some very deep modesty in not getting into this project. Can you say more about that? Because for philosophers like ourselves, there is such a temptation to enter this thing. You know, Rawls said this theory will get a counter theory, and you have completely changed the frame of the conversation.
Well, I think that's indeed a very perceptive observation, actually, and I think I wasn't trying to provide an alternative theory of justice, but I was questioning whether there could be a theory of justice of that degree of reach and ambition.
Right.
That is, justice is a very central, I mean, one result of that, of having a theory of justice which is so ambitious, is that to put a lot of issues out of the domain of justice altogether. Because of the Rawlsian way of defining justice with a sovereign state and always looking for a perfectly just society, rather than saying would slavery, subjugation of women, removing them, reducing justice, would getting medical care to all and education to all reduce it, would having a medical insurance that covers everybody in America reduce it? That question doesn't become, they don't become issues of justice anymore, something else. And I was actually, he's a very close friend of mine, and he's a colleague here, but he's having a symposium elsewhere, and he's not here. And it's a pity, because he, if Tom Nagel had been here, I'd have raised him, because I did attack him in the book, I mean, criticize him. I also draw a lot from his work in my book. But when he said that the idea of global justice is a chimera, he had a notion what the theory of justice has to do. And in the absence of sovereign state, there is not such a thing. Well, and that, therefore it falls under the domain of humanitarianism. But that's not what people are fighting for, I think, when they get upset about injustice in the world. That's not the abolitionists we're fighting for. That's not what Mary Wollstonecraft and others, or John Stuart Mill was talking about in the subjugation of women. They were talking about something which would eliminate a major injustice. So in a sense, if there's a slight difference, and I think this applies even to your more comprehensive, which I thought a brilliant review of my book, which you did for New Republic, which I have to acknowledge is probably the best review I've got, not only because he's kind, which is helps, but also because it's so perceptive. But I thought one point, I think there are two points I had, I think one, I can't remember the other, but this one I remember since you reminded me, is that that it's not so much I'm not presenting a theory of justice. I'm saying, and I'm not even being so modest, I'm delighted that you think I'm modest, I think I'm saying that that's what a theory of justice would look like. It won't have that gigantic ambition to deal with it. It will deal with many issues that agitate us. I mean, it's a part of leading human life. And you know, in a sense, there are people who are doing just that. Adam Smith was doing that, yeah? I don't want to give a book talk here, but I did, next month will come out the Adam Smith's Theory of Moral Sentiment, 250th edition, which I wrote a long introduction to. It's quite clear that that kind of project is how we could you reduce injustice in the world. That's the project of Mary Wollstonecraft, of Marquis de Condorcet, a lot of other people at that time. So in a sense, the theory of justice became that gigantic project with Hobbesian, Kantian, Lockean, you know, coming all the way to Rawls, including, I would include my other friend, Ronald Borkin and Nozick and Tom Nagel, and being concerned with a perfectly just state, which I think is first is probably undefinable, secondly, unagreeable, not disagreeable, unagreeable, and certainly not achievable, even if you could. So I think in a sense that seemed to me to have gone off the rails. So I would like to be modest along with making an immodest claim that most theories of justice have gone off the rails, we have to pull it back. And that is a claim about the theory of justice.
I'll now ask Andrew Hara.
I'd like to continue the discussion, the question about justice, but particularly the question about global justice, because I think one of the most inspiring aspects of your work is the example of what it means to think about justice in a global world and from a global perspective. And one of the themes, certainly of the book, is the sense of parochialism in a good deal of existing work on justice, either that comes from the way in which particular ideas are constructed, or the way in which they're applied in the world, or maybe from the way in which a particular notion of reason is seen to belong to a particular part of the world. And then the question is, well, how do we overcome this? How do we fight against this parochialism? And you lay, I think you've used the words already this evening, distanced view. The idea that we must strive for a more distanced view, and you draw on Adam Smith and you use this idea and image of the impartial spectator. And it's always seemed to me that there are at least two things, or at least two possibilities at work there, both of which are captured in your work and in that book. One is the impartial spectator who is the abstract human being striving for reason, striving for the best argument, striving to convince people on the back of some universal reason. It's that impartiality that matters. And the other kind is the spectator that comes from a different place, that brings, in Smith's words, the eyes of his own or her own people to the debate, the wisdom of different cultures, of different places. And I've always wanted to sort of ask you how you see the relationship between those different things, the impartiality that comes from abstract reason on the one hand, and the distance that comes from other places and other cultures on the other.
Yeah. My views on this are very derivative on Smith. So I think, let me try to explain what I take Smith to be saying. I don't think I have much to add to that. Though it took me some time to figure out that that's what he is saying. I think he's saying that you need detachment. But it's very difficult to be detached from your culture if you're reared in it. So when you bring in a different perspective, it's not that you want to get the Chinese and the Indians and the Ethiopians to be there with their own culture in, but it ain't the local culture. And therefore questions will occur to you, it doesn't occur to others. I think one way of thinking about it, one of the questions that I think those of us who are involved and interested in human rights, is that why is it that often a bigger group is able to pass a more human rights respecting thing than a local group can? European Convention on Human Rights, with which Britain is struggling, it's not because Britain is anti-right generally, but it's just that the problems in Britain are not the problems that worry the French or the Dutch or the Swedish, and therefore there is a liberation. Similarly, most of the changes that's occurred in India, for example, including this ultimately the big thing that happened with getting greater recognition of women's rights, tended to come from the Supreme Court and Parliament rather than from the local bodies. So despite all the praise that local knowledge gets these days, there is a point about global knowledge. But global knowledge, in the Smithian understanding, is partly freedom from the limitations of local parochialism. And he is bothered by that throughout the book, and I quote some of these passages. It's not often recognized how tense he was about slavery. Of course, he was tremendously tense. How upset he was about white supremacy. I quote a sentence where he says, it's an extreme statement of Smith. Smith was, contrary to his very measured conservative image, he was given to making extreme statements. And he says, he's very clearly upset about the treatment of Africans in the slave trade. And the exact sentence is something like, there is no Negro in the continent of America who does not have a much greater understanding of justice, which his sordid master is incapable of imagining. Now, he couldn't have believed that. He couldn't believe that absolutely every African has that, and none of the Europeans do. But I think what he was trying to say is as a corrective. I have to take another example. Puzzling one. When I first read it, I found it quite fascinating. This is, do you know Adam Smith on potato? It's a neglected part of, you have to correct your reading. Potato is a subject on which he had any view, very strong views. It goes like that. And if you have to figure out what's going on. He says that people think that potato doesn't have nutritional value. However, that view is not correct. Because I've studied, and it turns out that If you're looking for the strength of men, the strongest men in London happen to be the people who carry your photos, who happen to carry a chair, who carry this chair in Paddington and elsewhere. And who are the most beautiful women in London? And there Smith, on the basis of whatever research he might have done, comes to the conclusion that the prostitutes in Mayfair are the prettiest women in London. And then comes the, why is he going on that subject, especially since he knows almost as much about nutrition as you and I do? Well, the next sentence explained that. He said, both these strong men and the beautiful women are almost invariably Irish. And no further proof need be given about the nutritional value of the potato. So at one stage, what he is discussing is the nutrition of potato, but what he is discussing is the English prejudice about the Irish, including potato eating. Played a big part in the 1840s. If you might remember Trevelyan, who was in charge of Treasury, I'm sad to say, a product of Trinity College, Trinity College, Cambridge, he did say that one of the reasons for the famine is that the culinary art of the Irish peasant woman does not exceed the boiling of a potato. So it plays a very big part, and it goes all the way back to Spenser and Fairy Queen. So what Smith is doing is just upset about local prejudice. And then, you know, he's arguing these on, and he takes these positions. So I think the locality, the placing yourself elsewhere, is, in the case of potato, he's not doing that. He's just trying to say, look, even within the, I mean, he doesn't say, I mean, I quote him saying distant as well as near view. And this is the near view, but the better view, that if the Irish are eating potatoes, well, how come they are achieving all these things? So that's what he's doing. So I think there is a technology which he's using, which is not, it's not a cultural mixture that we don't, you know, we have to know what these cultures are doing. And he discusses the limitation of all of these cultures. He talks about the Chinese foot binding and so on, each of these. So I think that's the project is, that globalism, I mean, this relates to the question, again, to bring in Tom, again, one of his really very interesting books, namely A View from Nowhere. I think he's arguing that there couldn't be such a view. And this is not the sense in which Tom means, so it's not a comment on Tom. But the view from nowhere, in a more literal sense, is just not possible. And what Smith is saying is not that different from Tom. Namely, that you have to take views from very different places and then arrive at something. You know, it's not a question of looking from a view of the way, it's the amalgamation of the view. If I may use an analogy, that old Indian story about the blind men touching an elephant, one touches the trunk, one the tail, one the body, and describes the elephant like that. These are mistaken, but the alternative to the mistake is not to view the elephant from nowhere, but to view the elephant from everywhere, from all these places. And that's roughly the exercise that Smith is doing in A Moral Sentiment, and which I am trying humbly, modestly, following Smith in that respect. I'm very glad you asked that question.
Just one quick, yes. Just as a follow-up, but shifting the perspective a little, I mean, you talked here about, the advantages of distance and moving away. And the problems sometimes that can come from the local. And yet, in terms of striving and struggle for justice, the value that can come from local community, from group action, from the sense of agency. I mean, you mentioned very good reasons for being suspicious of communitarianism and communitarian positions. But isn't there a role for groups, for group agency, for those sentiments that bind groups together as part of the struggle for justice?
Yes, the groups have, I think there are three things to be said about groups. One is that groups are extremely important for enhance any objective that we individually want to do. The easiest example is trade unions. You may be that you want to make each individual worker's life easier, but you can do it through the union in a way that you could not individually. So the groups have a huge advantage there, but you don't judge the success of it by saying, my God, the trade union is doing well. You judge it by saying, look at the condition of the worker. They had made a difference. So that is a question where the group had, roughly speaking, instrumentality, but no intrinsic importance, but very important instrumentally. And the whole of the labor union, labor movement, feminist movement are based on that. The reach of the feminist movement across the world has been possible because of that group identity. But that's not because they want the group to flourish, they want them, that all women in the world to flourish and not be subjected to the same discrimination that they suffer from. But then the second is that the groups have sometimes a role because some of the things that we individuals want to do, even in terms of capability, are consisting of relationship with people. I mean, the value of a telephone lies in the fact that you can call other people up. But to say that, look, there's nobody else lives here, that everyone's gone, but here's a telephone for you, that wouldn't do much for me because it is it's an interactive activity. So groups will figure in individual life in a constructive way. So these are the two positive points. But the third point is the denial. I'm suspicious. And here I bring in my early childhood, for the same reason where Marx was, to bring in to think of that a group is doing well, even though no member of the group is doing well, is an absurdity. You cannot have an abstraction of that kind. If it is the case that every member, I mean, if you want to claim this group is doing well, you have to show in what way it's affecting the lives of the people there. So I think that's my position there. So I'm not against group, but there was so, in the communitarian discussion, not everyone, but because there's communitarianism such a wide field, but in many writings I've seen a real tendency to think as if there is such a thing as a flourishing of a group which is distinguished from and could not be in any way understood in terms of the individual thing. Not because of instrumentality, nor because of interactive freedom, but because a group has an identity of its own. That is much too Hegelian for me.
So like many of my colleagues, Professor Sen, I very much enjoyed reading your book, especially your recent book. And I wanted to pick up maybe to go back past potatoes to where you finished up with Moshe Halbertal when you were talking about the fact that the book, you argue in the book against, in a sense, a theory of justice. I know that's not quite what you say, it's providing a different kind of theory of justice. But
it rolls the theory of justice.
Right. But also against ideal theories of justice, against institutionalized theories of justice more generally. And one of the things I enjoyed a lot about the book, I think, is that it's full of counterintuitive ideas, ideas that at first sight seem implausible, but then on thinking about them turn out to be much more persuasive. And the idea of arguing for an approach to justice, arguing against an idealized theory of justice, but instead for an approach to justice that starts with egregious injustice, you know, starts at the lowest level and then works its way up from there, is actually a very appealing one. The reasons you give for it are that we can't get consensus on a substantive theory of justice in any case, and secondly, it doesn't help us concretely in addressing injustice on the ground. So you start with the concrete, address the most egregious cases of injustice, and then reason our way, using public reason, up from there. And so I found that very persuasive, but I also found myself thinking that we still need something sharper than that, you know, and that, yes, we can all, you know, we all have instincts and we can identify the worst cases of injustice, but don't we still need sharper criteria than that to help us guide our exercise?
By sharper criteria, what would you mean? What would be the characteristic of sharpness?
So, well, that's what I'm asking you in a sense, like how you would say to prioritize, there are egregious cases of injustice all over the world. How do we go about identifying?
How do we identify injustice when we don't know what justice is? Yeah, I think that the our understanding that there's some injustice somewhere is much more elemental. So much so that it may be tempting to think that you don't need anything other than sense of justice, but a revulsion, or etc. Which is not the case, because you do need a reasoning at some stage. But I think the reason, one of the causes of that belief is because there is an immediate communication of a sense of injustice. It's much easier to say, look at slavery. Some people treat it like that, others not. Or look at, like John Stuart Mill does, women with every man. Or look at racism, and so on, or casteism. And I think there it's much easier to identify that, look, this is not what I want. But you see, can I not say that this is not what I want without saying, what would be the ideal state? Obviously, I can't say it without saying, what would you like instead? I said, well, there could be one of many things. Which one? I said, well, any of them would be better. And I think it's a bit of a trap to think that without an idea of perfect justice, you cannot identify injustice. A, we do it all the time, and for a reason. Because some things are really upset. People get very angry about them. And there's a reason for their getting angry. People dying of hunger, children being undernourished in a country with a lot of food. You can't have the schools, you don't have the schools, and so forth. You carry out torture, even though the result of the torture is very rarely any kind of strategic advantage you get out of it. There are reasons to get upset about it, to say, look, I don't want that, not that. And then so give it. You see, it's a bit like that. Supposing you got stuck in a very bad experiment. You got stuck in a sauna. You went in, and you start the stand temperature on, and it's getting hotter and hotter and hotter, until you find it unbearably hot, and you decide to exit, because you cannot control it. And you find that the door is locked. So then you get a chap outside and you shout to him, saying, could you please turn the temperature? Could you please let me out? And he said, sorry, the door is stuck. I have to get a carpenter to sort this out. But until then, he said, well, can you reduce the temperature, please? And he said, of course I will do it, but let's be scientific about it. Tell me what is the optimum temperature you want. And I would say that he's talking gibberish at that moment. Because that's not the issue. The issue is to cut temperature down. And not to rank the various lower temperature. Should it be 60 degrees, 65, 70 degrees, or, you know. And I think in some ways my claim is, and this is I'm continuing to deny Moshe's kind, friendly, attribution of modesty to me. I'm trying to claim that basically the exercise on the theory of justice being based on a class of theories of justice which cannot move. It's stuck like a wintry morning. The car won't start until you get put a key in which tells you perfect justice is this. And then you can go in and say this was wrong, that was wrong. I want this car to start because that's the nature of the exercise. And the second, I began by saying A, and there's a B to it. And B, lots of people did just that. When John Stuart Mill was worried about women, when Marx was worried about, think about Capital Volume 1 of these terrible cases of exploitation of labor, he's not saying that that would bring in a perfect society, just society. Indeed, Marx himself in 1875, in last document, on critique of Gotha program said, you know, removing exploitation, giving people what they produce, right to labor, that's a bourgeois right. You can't be satisfied with that, ultimately. But what he's saying, look at the society around us, you know, Birmingham and Bradford and what's going on. This is just intolerable. So I think there's a question of distinction between these. And I would really like to argue with you that you call them sharpness. I wouldn't call it sharpness. And the extreme overambitiousness of being able to identify perfectly just nature of perfectly just society, and in the case of Rawls and others, in the form of perfectly just institutions, has a huge difficulty. It has three huge difficulties. A, we may not agree on what a perfectly just society would look like. B, we may not ourselves be quite sure what it is. If this person was stuck there, say, I don't really know what I want, 70 degrees, 65, I just don't know. I do want that, I don't want 110 degrees here. And so I think this, when a person is saying that, he's claiming something. And third is that even if we individually arrive at it and agree on it, we may not be able to achieve it. And fourth, D is that we don't need it in order to be able to say what is to be done today. And I don't think, the only serious historical point in the book is that there is a complete sharp distinction between the Hobbesian, Kantian, Lockean tradition of its modern theories of justice, and that includes the Rawls and Nozick and Dworkin and others, and the theories of justice which are intrinsically comparative and not just institutional, and not looking only for the what I call the transcendental position, which is the social contract tradition.
Can I respond very, very briefly to that? I'm just trying to think of a way of trying to explain what I mean by sharper criteria, because I'm not arguing that it's either an ideal theory of justice or nothing, but that you're appealing to something very attractive, which is we all know egregious injustice when we see it. But let's say you're a person stuck in the shower at a certain temperature. There's also someone stuck in the deep freeze, and there's someone stuck somewhere else. You know, how will the person know to whom he should go first? Who's, you know, how do we prioritize as between cases, you know, beyond just the most egregious cases, identifying, recognizing cases of justice where we should act?
Yeah, I think that's a very interesting question. My inclination there would be to say that, to say two things. One is that you may not be able to determine where to go, but there may be that incompleteness as to which one to give priority to. Maybe a big tragic choice if there's only one thing you can do and not two. But if that's the case, it's sad. That's why it's called a tragic choice. But that doesn't still eliminate the fact that you could say that rescuing the deep freeze woman or the superheated man would be both an enhancement of the society in which we are living. So I think it's a partial order mathematically. And there's a little bit of my old interest in maths, and a lot of my life was spent, if I spent was social choice theory, I spent 20 years. If I spent 10 years on famine. And there's a lot of discipline about partial ordering. You can say, it's amazing how many things you can say. And pretty people don't even recognize even any theory of even the gross national product is a partial ordering, even though it's pretended as if it's a complete ordering. It's always, everywhere there. Partial ordering is the prose we speak all the time. So I think the fact that it's a partial ordering, even if you can't decide. But secondly, sometimes you may be able to decide. There may be, you know, what I'm against is giving a principle which gives a priority. Always rescue the cold guy and go for the hot later. I don't think, but it depends on, I want to know how hot, how cold, how close to a heart attack is one person, and how close to dying a frozen death is the other. And given all that, I would take a decision on the basis of an enormous variety of information. And I do see those who look for a priority of principle, and unfortunately that's what you're referring to is true of John Rawls too. Theory of justice, there are just set of principles which are exactly right that emerges. Now that requires you to judge it at the level of principle, where there may be no priority of principles as such. I mean, they're all interesting, all good. And that's the second point where I was disagreeing. Moshe takes me a bit to task for saying that all of them are right. And you think, you surely what you mean is that all of them are wrong. But I want to say both. All of them are a bit right and a bit wrong. And so if that's the situation, then I think the it's not the fact that I cannot order the principle and don't have a predetermined priority of the principle, first principle, priority of liberty, second principle, something, third principle, etc. That doesn't mean that I can't actually decide. The alternative to having a priority of principle is not being, you know, inaction and perpetually stuck, inability to decide what is to be done. There is a lesson in the fact that in the old story of Buridan's ass, that even if you cannot, you ought to do something. I don't know how many people know here the story of the Buridan's ass. This is a famous ass, not owned by Buridan as far as I know, but discussed by Buridan. The ass was very confused by the fact that there were two haystacks which looked very luscious, and he couldn't determine which one would be better and to which one should go. So since he was a rational choice theorist, he dithered and dithered and dithered until he died of starvation. So the story is that even if you have an incomplete ordering, do something often, better than not doing anything, because that's distinctly the worst in this case. And secondly, sometimes you would be able to decide something at the level of practice, not at the level of principle. And the theory, nothing could be, in this view, right in theory but wrong in practice. If it's really wrong in practice, if the theory is not about practice, it can't be right in theory. And then if it is not about practice, then how could it be wrong in practice?
Okay. If I can intervene on this.
Yeah.
On two issues which we would probably agree are a major concern of injustice. If we took your global view, a view not from nowhere, but from everywhere,
yeah,
we might run into problems. One is gender equality. Because there we really see, if we look at a global view, that there are sharp divisions between East and West, the North and South, etc. And the other one is the way we regulate the position of religion in society. In the West, we struggle, but more or less we agree on the idea that there should be, it's fundamental that there should be freedom of religion and at the same time freedom from religion. So we would object that somebody should be discriminated or prevented from worshiping within reason, or that somebody should be cursed, etc. And also on this issue, if we took your global view, we would find remarkable differences. So here are two issues which are not trivial, that really go to central aspects of our self-understanding of an ordered society, on which there does not seem to be the same kind of intuitive identification of major injustice.
Well, you say they're not kind of intuitive. You have to look at these societies if free discussion is permitted and information is available. If I may come back to Smith, he discusses the case that in ancient Greece, everyone thought infanticide was fine. Aristotle defended it, Plato defended it. And he said, what's wrong with that? And that's not an Eastern society. Well, I think Greece to be East, but the Europeans don't usually, since they claim their ancestry intellectually from the Greeks. His argument is that they have been so used to the practice of infanticide that they have used to the idea of public utility that no society could survive unless you have infanticide. So they did not know that their society could survive even without infanticide, of which, incidentally, even in 6th century Athenian times, there were others, as it happened in the East, not in the West. as far as infanticide is concerned. But the basic point is that you get so mesmerized by practice and a lack of exposure that what would appear to be the standard Greek view, how could you combine the Greek view with the others? Well, the Greek view happened to be something which is now thought to be Eastern view rather than the Western view. I think there is a plasticity about it which is not unrelated to the engagement in which we are based. And if my book about the idea of justice is concerned with justice, it's also concerned about reasoning and the role of reasoning. And Rawls doesn't extend it beyond, well, he does extend it beyond the boundaries of the state when it comes to reflective equilibrium, but not in his justice and fairness. But I'm arguing that in the theory of justice too, you need a similar role of reasoning, which Rawls gives not to justice but to other virtues in the reflective equilibrium. So I'm taking a Rawlsian, Smithian position there, and I'm saying that it's not that these are immovable objects being encountered by irresistible forces. They're not like that at all. Secondly, what you take this to be the division between East and West, traditionally hadn't been quite like that. When Ashoka in the third century BC was talking about the freedom of religion of everyone, and that why everyone should be able to practice what he likes without being stopped, and why you have to listen to somebody respectfully and allow them to have religious practice, or you need to have no practice. Third century BC, I don't know of a single European figure I can think of at that time speaking on this subject. It is also worth remembering that even the virtue of democracy, the first three places where the Greek example are used are not Britain and Germany and France, not even Rome, which comes later. In the first three places is Iran, namely places like Susa, and there's a lovely thing in the British Museum if you went there about a plate about that, about their practice of local democracy in Bactria and in northwest India, under Greek influence. But it's interesting that the Greek influence goes first east rather than west. When Akbar in 1590s was lecturing on religious tolerance and mentioning that people should have the right to practice the religion that he preaches, and anyone should be allowed to go back in case under force he has been converted. That is exactly the same time, in fact his last speech was the same year, in which there were executions going on, including Campo di Fiori in Rome, for apostasy, people being burnt at stake in Italy. I don't think the East-West division is quite that way. And I think the important point isn't to say that, well, East is very good too. I'm not making that one. I'm making that there is a conditionality, contingency of beliefs which depends on cultivation. It's not a surprise that those countries where you think that individual rights have not much role and women's positions are not accepted, these are the places where Srinivasan's medal may be taken away, the Nobel medal being taken away by the government. These are the places where if you talked about individual rights, you may be put in jail. So I think if it is the case that the so-called Eastern unity of values requires a police, I'm not easily persuaded that that is the natural value that the society can alone produce. I think the mixture of both these questions, both gender, by the way, when Ashoka was talking 3rd century BC about the right of everyone, he did not exclude anyone, unlike Aristotle, who excluded slave and women about the same time. So I think it's a very complex picture, complex world in which we live.
Of course you assumed when I said East and West that I didn't mean it the other way around. I'm going to allow the
That would be wrong. I now have to say.
I'm going to allow Dixit at the last question.
So As you know, some colleagues and I have recently published a book on climate finance. The copies are sitting over there. We're going to have a very
short... We're going to release it, aren't we?
Yeah. We're going to have a very short launch event in a little bit. A central theme of this work is to look at how to generate the very large financial flows from developed to developing countries and the people living there to, on the one hand, help reduce greenhouse gas emissions, and on the other hand, to continue or even improve development for the benefit of the peoples there. And there are aspects both of achieving a global public good and aspects of justice in this. These revenues could be very large, and they're going to present a lot of the issues of development finance that you have written about so acutely in much of your work. And what are the lessons from your experience as we look forward to perhaps this new phenomenon of climate finance as to how this can be structured in a way to achieve both these environmental objectives and these development capability objectives?
Well, let me first say that I think it's an extremely exciting issue. I can't claim to have any special knowledge on climate finance. I'm reading your book with the greatest of care and admiration. But I think the general issue, if we move away from the finance, is a specific question, but how to think about the environment on the part of the poorer countries. And then, if you have to think seriously about it, finance has to come into it, clearly. Well, I think there are three very important issues to bear in mind, and which are illusions which we have to shed. One of them is that environment is a kind of consideration of the relatively affluent. Other people's lives are so badly affected by cholera, malaria, and AIDS and other epidemics that they don't have time to think about the environment. That's almost wholly wrong. The lives that are affected most are very often of the poorest, those who don't have a shelter to live or exposed and who live in the streets, who don't know where the next meal is coming from. Their ability to survive the environmental catastrophes corresponding the lower, all kinds of ways. There's lots of studies on that. So that's one thing to recognize. The second thing to recognize is that we would need, especially, I mean, there's a local climate, which is a big issue, but if we take global climate, especially since as Copenhagen approaches, we're thinking about that. So if I may look specifically at that, I think there's a kind of clash of two positions that come on, which seems to me each deeply questionable. One is a position that many of the countries have taken, namely China, India, Brazil, and others, namely that West has polluted the world a lot. It's our turn to do some polluting, and you can't really, West is, can't be serious when they want us to stop. Even today, there's more pollution coming out of the West, though China is catching up on that. But generally, if you take that's the stock up there, not just the flow today. In that stock, the West has a hugely more bigger share than China today has, even if flow-wise it catches up. Now, the question there is, where do you go from there? If you take the need to for the West to do something, either pay a bigger burden in the financing of that, which is one of the demands, or when it comes to allocation of quotas, to accept that you can't determine only on the basis of what's going on right now, you have to look at the history. I think there's a difficulty that historical injustices are very difficult to undo, and it's not unrelated to the group question that you're asking, in fact. But I think one of the things we learned from Nelson Mandela and Desmond Tutu and Martin Luther King, is that what you don't try to do is to get some kind of reparation from the past. What you want to do is to recognize that the past makes our life very unequal today. And is that what you want to eliminate? And the rest is a matter of remembering, recognizing, and even perhaps regretting, but not a retribution argument. So I think if there is a Chinese-Indian-Brazilian argument, it's not a retribution argument. It's not that you have done it, we penalize you for it. Though people who did it are not even here, they're gone. And they didn't even know what the effects of the environment would be. Charles Dickens may be writing about London fog, but there's no understanding that that's raising the global temperature at the same time. So I think in all kinds of ways that you have to bring it to the fact that the already developed countries have come to occupy a hugely bigger part of the global commons than you'd expect on the basis of the division of population. Not just today, sometimes people say this is because population is growing so fast in Asia and Africa. The ratio of non-Western population today is slightly lower than it was in the 1650s. What happened is that the West had a dramatic increase. Britain went from 5 million to 25 million in a few decades. And basically what's happening now is catching up on that. 1650, 1750 still, I think the UN estimates is by 2050 they will catch up with what it was in 1750. So I think taking the population share and what you would expect the kind of sharing, you would have a contract which is sensitive to the requirement. I'm not giving a formula here. And there would be no perfectly good, we have come back to perfect justice. There were several formulas which are better than not taking note of that. But the third mistake was on the Chinese and the Indian side, saying we won't accept any contract. So the Chinese are beginning to slightly move, the Indians haven't fully moved here. And I think that's unacceptable, A, because it's a global problem and you have to accept contract. You could say the contract would be fair, but you can't say I'm not going to sign any. And thirdly, the other thing to recognize is that there is another group of countries, not old polluters and new polluters, but non-polluters yet, namely Africa. China and India does not want to do for Africa, should not want to do for Africa, what America and Europe did for China and India. Namely, fill up the global common in such a way that there is nothing, there's no room for them at all. So I think you have to bring in also parties which are not there, which are not represented in G20. Very important to recognize the G20 is a membership of the growing, fast-growing countries, whether poor, like China or India, or rich, like America and Europe. But there's also another group whose voice is extremely important, and I've been very depressed to see how little this group attention, the attention of these, our attention has been drawn to the interests of these groups in the context of the environmental debate, along with other debates because of the G20 thing. There is a real problem there. So I think that's the direction I'd go. The global financing comes into it because this would require China and India and Brazil to do something, and Africa to begin in a way that they're less of a polluter when they start, right from the beginning. That would require a lot of financing and so on. But there I would bow to your expertise and why I think, if I may, giving sales talks, why it's very important that people should buy your book immediately and study it.
They will have the opportunity.
Okay, we are drawing to a close. It's our custom when we have guests like this on an evening like this to conclude with a few personal questions. We would like to know your favorite author.
One author.
The favorite for this evening.
Well, if it has to be one, it will have to be Shakespeare, I think.
And your favorite music?
That would be much more complicated. My son, who is a musician, would never forgive me for not putting his category in that group. But I think Mozart, probably. I'm sorry, I'm betraying my no east-west thing here a lot. I like South Indian classical music very
much. Is there any rock group?
Rock group too, including my own sons, Kabir Sen. Yeah.
And maybe lastly, your favorite movie or film director?
That's a hard competition between things that shaped my life so much in my, when I was describing my Calcutta days. These were the time of Bitter the Seeker and the Bicycle Thief and Miracle of Milan and so on.
Italian realism.
Italian realism and Satyajit Ray. I think it's very hard to beat him, I think. There I have to accept him. I mean, I began with some great sense of discretion. My father once described to me that when I was three, I was asked by one of my uncle, who do you like more, your father or your mother? And I have apparently given the wise answer, saying it's a draw.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, before I thank Professor Sen and the other panelists, we're going to have a very short presentation of this book on climate finance. So, Dick.
Thank you. I'm going to ask my colleagues Benedict Kingsbury and Bryce Rudick to come up. And our guest, Georg Kell, please.
Thank you. Georg Kell is going to make a, this book was just published. It grew out of a conference at in Abu Dhabi that NYU Abu Dhabi put on in May. So it's put together, published in very short order. And copies will be available at the reception, which will be very soon. Georg Kell is the executive director of the Global Compact, climate on my mind, of the United Nations. He's been the executive director since it was initiated by Kofi Annan in 2001. It is the largest corporate social responsibility program in the world, with a vast number of corporations who have subscribed to 10 principles of sustainability and corporate social responsibility. It also involves governments in developing and developing countries, local networks, NGOs, and UN agencies. And Georg and his colleagues in the office run this program, connect these people, and try to encourage and support socially responsible business behavior. Climate is very much on their agenda now. And as Professor Sen mentioned, the Copenhagen meeting starts next week. So we hope this is a very timely publication. Thank you, Georg, for joining us.
No, thank you. It's a great pleasure and a great honor, obviously, for me to be here to speak after this eminent panel. Professor Sen, I'm also a fan of your books, and I have next to my bedside, actually, your latest book. I haven't quite finished it yet, I must admit. But it's a great pleasure to be here because climate finance is arguably the most topical issues of the day, and I predict not just of today, but of months and if not years to come. Next week, the United Nations will convene a huge conference in Copenhagen, trying to bring to a conclusion 2 years of tough negotiations, trying to find consensus between North and South and East and West on the most complex and difficult issues of all, namely how to regulate the air. And I must confess that until 2 years ago myself, I was a skeptic on climate change. I always assumed somehow human ingenuity will find solutions by itself and we will respond in time to avoid what many leading economists have long predicted, that is early action pays off and is cheaper than paying a higher price later. But I must say that over the past 2 years, traveling widely in China and Africa and other places and dealing with many corporations who are huge emitters of greenhouse gas emissions, and also having followed the science a little bit on this issue, I have truly become convinced that this is the most transformative issue on the global agenda ahead of us, and surely we are not yet prepared to deal with it. The stakes could not be higher. When I came across this book a couple of weeks ago, I saw a manuscript. I was thrilled, quite frankly, because the book Climate Finance brings together quite complex issues in a coherent manner, explaining how global and local approaches to financing climate change can be done in a coherent way and offering both an analysis and pretty good recommendations on how to move ahead. I want to congratulate truly the editors of this book, Richard Stewart, Benedict Kingsbury, and Bryce Rudick, for putting together this book. I wish every negotiator moving to Copenhagen next week will have read this book. I'm afraid they won't, because consensus is still far away. Ivo de Boer, the UN top official on climate change, defined four necessary elements to be achieved next week. The first one is developed markets must commit to deep cuts on greenhouse gas emissions. Secondly, developing countries should be incentivized to also make commitments to measures to curb additional greenhouse gas emissions. And thirdly, the issue of finance. The World Bank and others agree that up to $100 billion a year are needed urgently to mitigate and offset climate impact. And fourthly, we need the governance structures to put in place to make this all happen. The book addresses all of these issues, in particular the third and the fourth. Now, for those of you who are still skeptics on the climate agenda, I just want to quote a few figures here. And there is scientific certainty that certain things will happen if the global average temperature rises, and scientists by and large agree that 2 degrees Celsius is a tipping point beyond which irreversible and potentially catastrophic changes will kick in. Nature, unlike financial markets, don't bail out. Now, the argument that there is not enough certainty, as Martin Wolf yesterday so eloquently argued in the Financial Times, must be actually pretty strong in order to justify inaction. In other words, if by any means we are rational, if by any means we think into the future, and if by any means we are capable of organizing action today in order to prepare for the future, the time is indeed not only now, it was already yesterday. I'm convinced that this is the single biggest transformative issue before us, and many agree with that. They accept the main body of science and urge on the basis of rational argumentation. Awareness is growing, but the will to act is not yet there, because we know that human beings often move in herds and they only are incentivized to react once the evidence is before them. Now, on the impact of climate change, a growing body of observations indicate that it's already here with us. We have to understand that warming of the temperature fundamentally affects all aspects of human activity and natural activity, food security being on top of it. On top of the 1 billion people that go hungry to bed every night, predictions are that up to 100 million more will impact it by 2020 if no drastic measures are taken. Access to water, we know very well what droughts mean and what melting of glaciers will mean in terms of water supply. Already 1.3 billion people lack access to clean water. That figure is supposed to go up dramatically. Displacement, rising sea levels, and we don't have to be doomsday projections on this to know that climate migration is already on the move. Many have already counted, and there are up to 20 million people already on the move because of the implications. So the urgency for action is pretty clear. How to go about the complexity of the north-south-east-west issue is still not quite settled, I may say, and the book here gives not only insight and analysis, but also gives us good guiding principles on how to design such schemes. The good news, just to end on a more positive note, is that most of the knowledge and technology in order to deal with the issues is readily available. What is missing is really implementing and bringing to scale some of the solutions. And the key, obviously, is to price the negative externality and to bring it into the marketplace so that incentives are set for low carbon growth in the East and in the West. So again, my congratulations to the authors, and I hope that this small contribution is a little bit of a wake-up call too, because it is sometimes difficult to act on the basis of knowledge alone, and it is not enough for human instincts and behavior to translate this into action. But if this debate now steers up, and if more and more people start to look into it, I'm convinced that over time we will be able to muster the necessary political will. Thank you very much, and congratulations.
Thank you very much. And now I'm going to turn it over to my colleague, Benedict Kingsbury, for a few further remarks on our activities in this field.
So this is luckily no more than 25 minutes of a speech. So I think one idea of having this book launch this evening was to reassure the Straus family that not only were there some Straus fellows, but they're actually doing something. So all 14 of us, I think, have substantial projects. This is one that happens to have come to fruition right now. But I think having been one semester already as a Straus fellow with Dick Stewart and our other 12 colleagues, I can say with confidence that it's really producing things. There's really top quality work on cutting edge topics going on there, and it's really a pleasure to be associated with it. And I think I speak on behalf of all of the Straus fellows in thanking the Straus family for the vision of willing to trust us and the Straus Institute in this way with these resources, and to thank Joseph Weiler and the whole staff of the Institute for the imagination and sort of charismatic inspiration which has got the whole enterprise to the point that we've seen this evening. Just to connect this particular book on climate finance with this theme for this year of the Straus Institute, which is global governance, the exercise of power in the international public space beyond the state. This NYU Law School, as many will know, is the number one ranked international law program in the United States, has been for a long time. We have probably 15 faculty working on global issues of some sort, traditional international law, but many more things: global competition law, environment, intellectual property, strong group on human rights, international economic law, big conference on development finance the next 2 days, which our colleague Kevin Davis is running, and a lot of other issues. So, and it's really a group which functions together on the basis that these issues are too hard for one person, and that the traditional academic style of each person having their own empire and looking disdainfully at everybody else isn't the way to address these things. And we've tried hard within the school to get beyond that. We've tried ourselves to, I think, perhaps symbolically, the kind of Adam Smith sentiments that were nicely encapsulated in Amartya Sen's brilliant work and his oration tonight. Joseph Weiler and I taught a course for international law students, of which the required reading was Adam Smith's Theory of Moral Sentiments. So we're very much in company with you there. It's really trying to connect lots of perspectives. And so we in this project on global governance that this group of international lawyers has run, Dick Stewart and I and many others, have worked in India with Pradhat Mehta Center for Policy Research in Delhi. We've just published a book from Cape Town with the University of Cape Town Law Faculty. We just published another one last week with some colleagues in Buenos Aires, a team of lawyers, public interest people, economists and others there. And we've been working also in China, in Europe, and in this case of this project in Abu Dhabi. So it's one element of taking NYU into the world and of trying to engage in global governance issues, not just staying in New York, but trying to hear and understand what are people doing, what are the priorities, what are the ideas, how can we make this enterprise serious, better, build the capacity to really influence what gets done when a global negotiation has to happen, as is happening with climate change in the next 3 weeks in Copenhagen. So that's the spirit of this. We've had a lot of help in this case from NYU Abu Dhabi Institute. We're deeply thankful to them for financing the conference and for John Sexton's imagination and urging us to go and do this in Abu Dhabi as part of NYU in the world, not just the law school, but the whole university. At the same time, though, it's crucial to address issues like this, to try to bring things together where we can here. And that's what the Straus Institute is remarkably doing, bringing this very talented group together each year. This year's theme of global governance, it really begins with the idea that more and more things are being done beyond the state and have to be done beyond the state. So what we try to teach our law students at NYU and in our research is, well, that global regulation means you've got to understand a lot of actors coming together at once. It's going to be states getting together in Copenhagen, yes, but it's going to be corporations acting through the Global Compact and others. It's going to be NGOs, human rights groups, people focused on development. It's going to be the structure of traditional international organizations like the UN and the World Bank and new forms like the Global Fund, Global Private Partnerships, public-private partnerships. So we've got to see a whole lot of actors all moving together. Second is that it keeps moving all the time. You don't just make a rule, adopt the tax code years ago, adopt the constitution and its amendments, and that's it. No, you have to keep moving, like a regulatory process within a state, but much, much more complicated globally. And we try to equip our students and write in our own research how to work in that environment, not the old rule and is it being enforced or not kind of stuff. Not just to look at, well, the states have made a rule, are they implying it or not? International laws out there, national laws down here, they're two different things, and it's just a little bit of a bridge. No, that a lot of global governance now is about motivating private actors. It's about getting corporations to take a different view on sustainability, climate change. It's about mobilizing the shifts in incentives through markets, or the penalties, the discouragement, the reputational effects, the influence of availability of financing to help very poor people to start to use more cleaner fuel, while at the same time producing more food that they can eat for themselves, to take account of gender inequalities, which mean women get not served any food because they serve all the males in the family. First, there's nothing left. To take account that in many countries, life expectancy is under 40. People are dead before they're 40. Fortunately, it didn't apply to me, many of us. But that's the reality of a global regime, and it's not enough to think, what is it like for us who expect to live to 80 or 90 to care about the environment? That it has to be something which seriously integrates that kind of diversity, and that's been, I think, the theme of tonight's discussion. So it's those themes of global governance and how to think about them that the Straus Institute is pursuing seriously this year. Climate finance is one example, but each of the fellows has got some particular project in some major area, and the sharing of ideas amongst those has been so far very fertile, and I think will produce a lot of results. And I think to end on what's really been the theme of the whole evening and of the launch of the Straus Institute, this key idea which we try to have all over the law school and which Joseph Weiler really personally embodies. It's not just Institute for the Advanced Study of Law. It's law and justice. And these things have got to come together. We've got to teach our students that. We've got to think like that. We do our research. We've got to take seriously that as a sort of element of our own morality, wherever it comes from, of our public responsibility. And we hope that these elements of justice which come through in the climate area, which are not easy, but which something can be done, sort of emblematic of what can be done generally as we approach global governance. Not just opportunistic politicking, doing the best for ourselves, our country, forgetting about everybody else, but something a bit more, something which in the Straus Institute is called the global public space, the international public space, and defining its values as part of what's going on this year and I think long into the future.
Ladies and gentlemen, after I finish with my thanks, everybody is invited to a reception which will take place in the room from which we came into this hall. And the guest, the dinner guest of the Straus family, will move to the next building, D'Agostino, for dinner. So now all good things come to an end. We have a little gift for you, Professor Sen.
I'm supposed to demonstrate it by convention. I don't know what it is.
It's an antique map of India.
Thank you. Nothing could be nicer.
We want to thank our panelists. Thank you very much, all of you. I think you will all agree that we were tonight in the presence of a very special human being. We want to thank Professor Sen. And last but not least, we want to thank the Straus family and all of you, ladies and gentlemen, who graced us with your presence. Thank you very much.